Okay, ladies and gentlemen, please turn off all cell phones and beepers. We'd like to begin. Rabbi Yisrael Meir Lau, Chairman of the Yad Vashem Council, Mr. Avner Shalev, Chairman of the Yad Vashem Directorate, Mr. Natan Eitan, Director General of Yad Vashem, Mr. Dorit Novak, Director of the International School for Holocaust Studies, ambassadors from Australia and Sweden, Professor Yehuda Bauer, educators from Israel and abroad, Holocaust survivors, my colleagues from the International School of Holocaust Studies, ladies and gentlemen. We have gathered here today in the Valley of the Communities at Yad Vashem, a monument in which names of thousands of Jewish communities destroyed or severely damaged in the Holocaust are engraved on the walls of stone around you. This evening, we mark the opening of the 8th International Conference on Holocaust Education, entitled Telling the Story, Teaching the Core, Holocaust Education in the 21st Century. We will start with a short film about the International School for Holocaust Studies.
When I come to this school, I have a very happy feeling. I know that my story, story of my family in the Holocaust, will be carried on by generations and generations of pupils and teachers. The Holocaust will not die together with me.
נשארתי לבד, הייתי נער בריא ורציתי לחיות.
הייתה לי משפחה, היא נמחקה כולה. הקמתי משפחה בשנת 70, יש לי 6 נכדות ונכד.
היה ברור שלא יוצאים חיים, ובכל ותמיד קיווית שתעבור את היום.
Something that I wasn't before.
Limitless Resource Center.
Coming back from the Congress, I realized that I wanted to continue my confrontation and my learning about the Holocaust.
Within a couple of years, there'll be no Holocaust survivors left.
אני רואה כאן את העתיד ולא רק את העבר.
אני מאמין שאי אפשר לקיים זיכרון משמעותי, נמשך לאורך שנים, בלי לעסוק בעבודת החינוך. לצורך זה היה לי חזון, להקים בית ספר מרכזי, בינלאומי באופיו, ביד ושם, שיכשיר מורים, שיגע בתלמידים, ואז נבנה את הכלים ונוכל לתת משמעות נמשכת לעשייה מדור לדור.
ובהיותו מרכז למורים מן הארץ ומן העולם, למחנכים מן הארץ ועולם, שבו מקיימים דיאלוג חינוכי יוצר שנוגע בשאלות של איך נכון וראוי ללמד את השואה, לתלמידים עכשיו.
הדינמיקה הזאת, היכולת שלנו לנוע קדימה ולהישאר רלוונטיים לזמן, לשאלה של הצעירים, היא מכרעת.
I am honored to invite the director of Yad Vashem's International School for Holocaust Studies, Mr. Dorit Novak, to the podium to address the conference.
Well, good evening, all of you. I'm really excited to see all our friends from all around the globe, and a special welcome to the members of the Yad Vashem Directorate and Council that are joining us this evening, and Holocaust survivors that, as you've seen in the film, are really part of the family of the school. Well, two months ago, I took part in a Gathering the Fragments project that Yad Vashem runs. This project is about asking Holocaust survivors and their family to bring artifacts, photos, diaries, whatever they brought from there, and to put it at Yad Vashem for being preserved for future generation. Into the room walked a nice-looking woman, holding in her hands three children's books, Polish children's book, with beautiful paintings. And she said, those books represents all the life I left there, all my childhood, everything. Nothing was left but these three books. I want these three books to be preserved in Yad Vashem, because it contains my story. Then she sat down and she started telling her story. Her name was Bara, a shortening of Barbara. She was born in Warsaw. Her father, originally from Vilnius, was sent by the family to Warsaw as a representative of the family oil company. They were quite wealthy family. She had a loving father, mother, and a Polish nanny. Everything was fine until the war broke. When the war broke, the father said, in this kind of time, family has to stick together. And he said, we are going back to Vilnius. He took his daughter and his wife, and he asked the nanny to stay in their home, in their flat, keeping an eye on everything. But he told her, if she will feel any threat, she should leave the flat, she can take whatever she wants, keep it, and go away. Bara and her family moved to Vilnius. There they joined their family. After a while, they found themselves in the Vilnius ghetto. And then one day, the father was taken to one of the transports, to a labor camp. And since then, that moment, Bara never saw him again. She was left with her mother, and then the family decided that the woman and the child would be safer if they will hide in a family of a friend of a family friend that lives in Vilnius. They left the ghetto, and they found hide in their friend's flat, waiting for him to arrange for them false identity papers in order to move to the village, one of the villages surrounding Warsaw. In the morning, he used to go to work, and they stayed very, very quiet in the flat. At that moment, these three books become very meaningful to her. her mother read it to her and reread it to her, and she, and that was, you know, everything was surrounded those three books. One day, one evening, as they were sitting with a friend, they heard a knock on the door. Immediately, Bara and her mother went into hide, and then the friend opened the door, and there was a woman standing there, and she said, "I'm here for Bara and her mother." He said, "Nobody's here. I mean, I'm here alone." And then she practically felt on her knees, kissing his feet, saying, "I'm Bara's nanny. I'm here for her." So we let her in. And Bara said, "Till today, I don't have the clue. I don't have any idea how she found us, but she did." She stayed with them for a few days, and then she convinced Bara's mother to move back to Warsaw, because she said, she described the ghetto in quite colorful, I would say, quite colorful colors. And she said, "You know, you'll be with your friends, there is music there, there is a theater there, you'll be fine, and I'll get," that's what the nanny said, and "I will arrange for you a false identity papers, and then you'll move to live next to your sister that was married to a German origin Pole that lived in one of the villages surrounding Warsaw." The mother was convinced, and the two women with the young child did their way back to Warsaw. They entered the ghetto, they stayed there for a while. The nanny, as she promised, she succeeded to arrange for them a false identity papers. She rent a flat for them in the village, in a house that belonged to a Polish officer that went to the war, and the family needed more income, so they rent a flat there. And the nanny, slowly and very discreetly, sold the property of the family that she succeeded to keep, and in order to give them provision, to give them some food, and the books were there with them. Well, the war is over. When the war was over, the mother, of course, discovered that there was no one left from her family. The only few family members that was left were left in Vilnius. Those were Bara's father's family, and they moved back to Vilnius. Her mother found work. Bara started studying. She entered school, Christian school, and she was describing very colorful when the communion time arrived. And her mother convinced the nuns there that Bara is not feeling very well. She's sick. She went through a tough time. So maybe because nobody knew she is Jewish, of course. And things start, you know, seeming fine. And then the uncle that they were living with, her father's brother and his wife and his son, come one day and he said, "I got a certificate for Palestine. We are leaving." Bara said, "I was trying to convince my mother to join them, but no, Polish kids," that's what she said, "has to be like fishes. They don't suppose to speak, they don't suppose to listen." So I was quiet. But a week later, my mother took me, she took a luggage and said, "We're moving." Bara knew that she shouldn't ask anything. She found herself in Paris. Her mother contacted one of the Jewish agencies there, and then they moved to Marseille. And in Marseille, they met their uncle again. The uncle took her to court, took Bara, claiming that he's her only adult from the family that survived. He got a custody on her. He bought tickets for her, and they went on a boat to Palestine. The mother was left on the shore. Bara and her uncle were on the boat. It was a tourist boat, and she said, "I was terrified, because I didn't know how I will go down. I knew that I don't have any certificate. I was grown up enough to know that." And she said, "If somebody told me, or I just imagine, that they're going to put me in one of the luggage, and you know, one of this huge crane will take me and drop me on the shore." And she said, "I was sure that I will not survive going down this boat." She said, "I was terrified all the way." Luckily, when they arrived, the first day arrived to Beirut, then they arrived to Alexandria, and then they arrived to Haifa. In Haifa, a tall man in uniform climbed the boat, put a hand on her shoulder, and just took her out of the boat, and she was there. And again, she started rebuilding her life. She learned Hebrew. She got rid of her Polish accent. After a year, she was a very, very Israeli girl. Feeling again that everything is settling down, but that was not the end of it. One day, her uncle said, let's go and meet your mother. She went again to Haifa, and from the boat, a very elegant lady, dressed with the hottest Parisian, fashion, with a hat and a veil, and, you know, like European in the desert. She said, and Bara said, my mother never found herself here. She was always a European. She was always an immigrant. She never felt comfortable here. The heat is too strong. The people were, and she said she was always looking at me as a rude Israeli girl. I was not European at all. Luckily, Bara said, my mother found and saw another man, Holocaust survivor. She didn't appreciate him very, very much, but they got married. And that was my luck. That's what she said. He had a son that survived. He lost his wife in the war. And Bara said, this son became the best uncle my children can ask for. A few years later, they were living in a very small, tiny flat in Ramat Gan one day. And who arrives? The nanny, again. The nanny was there. And the nanny lived with them. Again, Bara said, I don't know how she reached us. I don't know how she came. She came from Poland. Poland was closed. But she came. She did it. And she stayed with them until her last day. She's buried today in one of the cemetery of one of the churches in Jerusalem. And Bara is keep visiting her once in a while. And she is there. 7 years ago, she got the Righteous Among the Nation title. And here, she finished her life. And she is buried. That was the story, and everything was encapsulated in this for Bara in this three children's book. In a way, this story is a very unique story on one hand, but on the other hand, it represents so many similar stories that contain so many of the ingredients of the Holocaust, so many components that combine the core of the Holocaust. There is the wandering Jews, there is the people going from the east to the west and from the west to the east. There are family ties. There is the Zionism. There are people that integrated into the new society. There are people that never found a real place for themselves. That the Holocaust really broke the world, and it was never been repaired again. And this conference is about these core components of the conference that we are starting today, about these core components of the Holocaust. About reminding ourselves what are the main components. When we're talking about the Holocaust, what are we talking about? And the first day of the conference will be dedicated to learning the factual and historical and components that combine the Holocaust. The second day will be dedicated for us educators and our responsibility to translate the fact, the knowledge, the historical evidence into meaningful educational experience. We are going to share them with each other. Many of the people that sitting here today will be presenting their experiences, their best practices. We will discuss it, we will learn from each other, and hopefully we'll be able to go back home with new methods, new pedagogy, new ideas in our package. The third day we'll be sitting in three different, interest groups that represent different environment of Holocaust education and of Holocaust teaching. One group will be people from museum and memorial sites that share similar challenges. The other group will be teachers that teaches in universities and schools. And the last third group will be people that are teaching in Jewish educational environment. Every group will have a discussion about how to implement Holocaust education within their perspective environment, educational environment. The last day, we're going to have another meaningful thing, and this is a meeting with survivors. As long as the survivors are with us, we will be willing to listen. We'll be willing to listen, as they're fading out and fading away naturally, we educators have a responsibility to keep on the message. to carry on their stories. As I think a few years ago, Elie Wiesel said here, we are the messengers of the messengers. If they are the messengers of this story, we are taking the message for them and we transfer it to others. Or in other words, I can quote Hannah Bariesha, one of the Holocaust survivors, that the last few years is running from place to place without resting a minute and telling her story. And when she was asked, where do you have all this energy from? She looked at us and she said, I'll tell you, in a few years I won't be here anymore. And I'm sure when the story of the Holocaust will be told, people will say, it didn't happen that way. It doesn't make any sense. Can't be. So there will be young people that will be said, we were not there, but she was there, and she told me. And I think that's the message. That's what we're talking about. Listen to the survivors, hearing the story. They will tell us, and we will tell our students. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dorit. 8-year-old Lulik was entrusted by his mother to his brother Tulik, Naftali, moments before she was taken to her death. Tulik smuggled the child from cattle car to cattle car, from camp to camp. Time and again he was caught and hovered on the brink of death, but survived. Tulik survived with him and was both father and mother to young Lulik. Together they reached Eretz Yisrael, and carrying on an unbroken chain of rabbis going back generations, Lulik Yisrael eventually became chief rabbi of Israel. Today is the chief rabbi of Tel Aviv and Yafo and director of the Avishem Council. I have the honor to invite Rabbi Yisrael Meir Lau to address the conference.
Avner Shalev, the chairman of the Yad Vashem direction, Mr. Natan Eitan, the director general of Yad Vashem, Mrs. Dorit Novak, the director of the International School for Holocaust, members, dear friends, of Yad Vashem Council and Yad Vashem Directorate, educators from Israel and from all over the world who came to participate at this seminar today, Your Excellencies, the ambassadors of Australia and Sweden, the personnel of the Yad Vashem International School, ladies and gentlemen. As a survivor, we can never escape from the memories, from teaching and telling the story, even today. I must start with a very personal excitement of today. I'm invited many weeks ago to spend the coming weekend in Seattle, northwest of the United States, close to Vancouver already in Canada, to spend with the Jewish community, not a dinner, not a lunch, not any fundraising, just to spend in the synagogue, the Jewish environment. Today I receive a phone call. A lady in Seattle, not Jewish, she is in a nursing home. Her age is 104, very clear, very sharp. She has seen in the newspaper, the local newspaper, weekly, that Rabbi Lau arrives to Seattle for the weekend. Maybe there were some details about my life, my curriculum vitae, I don't know. Please, she phoned to the rabbi of Seattle, whom I don't know yet. Do me a favor. I can't walk out from the nursing home because of my age. If I can meet the rabbi for 5 minutes. The rabbi there asked her for what, why. She said, I was in the army, in the American army, with General Patton. We have liberated Buchenwald concentration camp, East North Germany. There was a clinic there, an hospital. And the brother of Chief Rabbi Lau was my patient. I was the nurse in that battalion of General Patton. And I took care days and nights with his brother, who was closer to die than to live. If he can spend 5 minutes with me, because of those days and nights I spent with his brother, that Naftali. So I promised the rabbi that after 18 hours flight, straight from Tel Aviv, New York, from New York to Seattle, my first station before the hotel will be the nursing home to meet this lady, 104 years old. And I told immediately to my brother, do you remember? He said, of course. 60% of the survivors of Buchenwald died in Buchenwald before we moved out. 60% of kinds of typhus and many other sicknesses. And she was the sister, the nurse. And I'm going to meet her this week on Thursday. Please go. This is just to tell you an episode from this day, last day. We can never escape from the story. As a believer and an observant Jew, I am not permitted to escape. Even if I would like to do so, it's forbidden for me. We have a commandment written in the Bible, Zachor, remember, this is a commandment. Velo tishkach, and do not forget. You will say it's the same, two sides of the same coin. It's two sides of the same coin, but there are two ways. Lo tishkach is in your heart and in your mind. Zachor is in your doing, in your activity. Zachor means do everything possible to remember and that it will be unforgotten. Zachor is do everything. Yad Vashem is the greatest Zachor you know. The school, the International School for Studies of Holocaust, this is a statue of Zachor. Not a statue of woods or stones, a living statue, a dynamic one. When you bring people, teachers, educators, professors, from over 50 countries in the world, and you spend time with them to tell them, to explain and to show. Main thing is to show. And to make them involved with this experience. This is our way as believers to keep our heritage, that one of its principles is Zachor, remember, Velo tishkach, and never forget. I remember a meeting with the former Pope, John Paul II, in Castel Gandolfo in Italy, in his summer house. The meeting was on September 93, means 19 years ago.
He was from Poland, as you know, from Wadowice, not far from the cities you see here, very close. Galicia, if you have here, Buchac of Agnon, Mofia Wadowice. In his city, there were 6,000 people. 2,000 of them were Jewish, he told me. He said to me, I want you to know. He said it with a smile. From the 4,000 non-Jews, almost everyone survived. From the 2,000 Jewish, almost no one survived. Still, in spite of that, the only friend of my childhood that I spend with him every week I meet him is Jerzy Kluger of Wadowice, a Jewish boy. We played football together, and he brought him here to Yad Vashem on March 2000 on his historic visit to Israel. He brought with him three cardinals and one Jewish boyfriend from his early childhood, Jerzy Kluger. They used to meet every week and to play chess together. The Pope was the survivor of Wadowice, Jerzy Kluger. Let their memory be blessed. The Pope told me on that meeting, we spoke 40 minutes, as a Pope, I visited already over 100 countries. Finally, he was in 120 countries. 93, there were over 100, he said. There is no one place in the world, and I spoke, that I didn't emphasize our commitment, our means mankind's, our obligation to the continuity, to the future of our senior brother, the Jewish people. And how can we do it? By telling the story of the Holocaust. To tell and to teach the core of it. How could it happen? Not only how did it happen, which is very interesting and very important, but how could it happen? From 1923, when the book My War, Mein Kampf, appeared, with no comment. In 1933, 10 years later, he became the chancellor, the ruler, the Führer of Germany, a very cultured nation, very cultured nation. Okay, there are stories with the Weimar process, the whole story of behind the coulisses of World War I, all the stories, but still the question is a question. Where was the German nation on January 1933 when they have elected him as the Führer of the nation? Knowing he never denied his purpose, his task, his way, his concept of life, and his feelings towards the Jewish people. His last will, his testament, ends, his politically testament, signed by four witnesses, Martin Burman, his deputy, Dr. Josef Goebbels, the minister of propaganda, and other two of his staff. The end of his last will, which means the last moment in the bunker in Berlin, April 9th, 1945, I obligate the followers of the German leadership and their followers to an pitiless resistance against the international poisoner Judaism, universal Judaism, the international poisoner. For a pitiless resistance, this is his last mind, didn't speak about children, about the wife, about his own people, about his friends, about his homeland. Österreich, Germany, what was really his homeland? The Jews, the international poisoner, universal Judaism. This is the last word of the Testament. The word Judaism is the last word. Hard to believe, but very important to teach, to tell. I have met here 1 hour ago with a lady who works in Yad Vashem. She's converted. She was born not as a Jewish girl, not her parents, both sides, father, mother, are not Jewish, from a country in east of Europe. Doesn't matter the details. When she converted, and she came to Israel, made Aliyah, and she lives in Jerusalem, before she became one of the workers here in Yad Vashem, in the archives, she knows many languages. She said, for me, it was a shock after the conversion to hear about the word Holocaust. I didn't know. And she comes not from a desert, not from a jungle, an Eastern Europe, not very wealthy, but developed and cultured nation and country. Universities are there. She didn't know. She asked her parents, what do you know? A word here, a word there. Why do you ask? Why do you raise this topic? We didn't behave correctly on those dark times. That's all. They have cooperated with the Nazis. She has discovered her parents, her teachers. She didn't know. So if you will not come here to participate at the international school, if Yad Vashem wouldn't establish this school, who will know? The lady in Seattle is already 104 years old. Who knows how many years she has to tell the story, what she has seen after the liberation. Those 60% people who died, they are also victims of Holocaust. And you don't count them in the 6 million. They are survivors. Survivors. They couldn't leave the land of Buchenwald, Weimar. They died there as survivors. Thousands. This lady will not tell the story. Who will? You will tell the story. Because you will spend here these coming days. Listen. Look. See, watch, be involved, emotionally involved with this tragedy which never happened before and hopefully will never reappear again in any place, in any time, against any nation. They are and they were disasters in the world. Some of them by nature that we couldn't prevent, we cannot avoid. A tsunami, an earthquake, in Asia, in Europe, in Latin America, or North America, in Mexico. But there are disasters made by human beings. Even the last century, after World War II, you remember Korea and Vietnam and Laos and Cambodia and Congo and Zaire and Biafra and Rwanda and Kosovo. 1 million people died for what? For whom? For nothing. 1 million in Europe. 1 hour flight from Germany. They didn't learn the lesson. But you can nothing compare to the Holocaust. Because none of these disasters and battlefields was systematically planned like Holocaust was many years ago. A system of liquidation of a nation. Never heard. We had wars, the Greeks and the Romans, the Syrian and the Persian and the Egyptian, and Hannibal against the Roman, and all kinds of cruise raids. 100 years of war, 30 years of war, both in Europe. But systematically, to make a plan how to liquidate innocent people just because they carry a name of the Jewish nation. So what did they do? This must be learned, must be taught, must be remembered. And this school is the way, the best way to accomplish this target. To have you, as Dorit said, messengers of us throughout the world. Tell the story, teach the call, and promise that such a story will never happen again. Thank you.